Hi, this is Everett Gunther. This is going to be a quick video showing how to use a couple of the new features that I just added to Ultra Dynamic Sky, in particular the dynamic landscape weather effects and the weather override volumes. So I have a simple test landscape here with just a couple of tiling rock textures. I'm going to go through the process of adding the dynamic landscape weather effects to this material, which should add dynamic snow and dynamic puddles which react to the player walking over them. So here I've opened up that landscape material. It uses a material attributes pin for the output, so the first step is going to be breaking that material attributes pin so that we can plug our inputs into the function. So break attributes, then the function is called dynamic landscape weather effects. And now I'm just going to plug in all the inputs from base color down to world displacement. The other inputs on this material function are for adjusting the effects across the surface. So you can mask the amount of snow that builds up, the amount of water that builds up. You can change the puddle color, things like that, anything that would change across the surface. So now I'm just using a set material attributes node to take all of the outputs from that function and bring them back into the material attributes pin to go into the output. And that's really all of the work in the material, so I'm going to go ahead and save and compile. So now I've made the changes to the landscape material, but we still need to do a few more things to set this up. First, I'm going to select the landscape actor and find in its settings Use Dynamic Material Instance and check that. Then I'm going to go and select Ultra Dynamic Weather and find the category called Dynamic Landscape Weather Effects. And I'm going to enable Dynamic Landscape Weather Effects. Another thing that's important to note is the Displacement Input Minimum Level and Displacement Input Maximum Level. These should be calibrated to match the range of the world displacement input that you are plugging into the function. The reason for this is that it uses that world displacement input to modify the coverage of snow and puddles on the surface. So if I go in and adjust material snow coverage down, you'll see that that world displacement input is making the snow form in the cavities first. If I turn down the influence of that effect and turn it up, you can see what's going on there. So just make sure that the displacement input minimum level and maximum level matches the range that you are inputting into the function using your world displacement. So now our material is capable of gathering puddles and snow, but as you can see, it still isn't responding to the player walking over them. We're going to handle that next. The interactions with the snow and puddles are driven by a special component called DLWE Interaction, so we'll have to add that to the feet of our character. Here in the third-person blueprint, I'm just going to select the player mesh and add a DLWE Interaction component. And I'll add a second one as well for the other foot. And to actually connect these to the foot of the skeletal mesh, I'm going to select the component and select a parent socket of foot L. Then I'm going to move the component into the center of mass of the foot. Then I'm going to do the same thing for the other one on foot R so that it can be connected to the right foot. So now those two interaction components will move with the character animations because they're parented to the feet, and they will leave ripples and create sound effects and particle effects when they interact with the puddles. And of course the puddles do react to weather, with rain and wind creating turbulence on the surface and all of that. And those same interaction components will also leave trails in the snow. All of these effects for snow and puddles are enabled by default in the material function, but you can disable any of them individually using static parameters, which are built into the function. The other feature that I wanted to introduce today is the new weather override volume, which allows you to apply specific weather to a region of your map. You can find the weather override volume in the blueprints folder inside weather effects. When I add one in, you can see that it's composed of a spline, which outlines a zone of the level. These weather override volumes have two modes. One is the single weather type mode, which applies one weather type permanently. And the other mode can generate a random weather stream, the same way that random weather variation does on UDW. The setting transition width is what defines how much space is devoted to transitioning from the inside weather over to the outside weather. You can adjust the shape of the region by simply adjusting the spline. You can move the spline points around. You can add spline points. And do that to outline arbitrary regions of your level. To show how this works, I'll go ahead and bring this down to a really small size so that we can see how, as the player moves into that transition zone, the weather will transition over from the global weather state, which right now would be partly cloudy, over to that rain inside the zone. It'll be a really sharp transition because it's so small. And as I walk back out, so that zone is just applying a permanent state of rain within the region. But if you change over to random weather variation, you can use the weather type probabilities to apply a custom, unique random weather stream for every weather override volume. Note that there's also a priority setting, so you can define what happens when multiple volumes overlap each other. .com. Thanks for watching.